So, irrespective of the algorithm, you use sklearn, and these are the three major steps that you perform. First, you create the object of the algorithm, then you fit the algorithm, then you predict. You're not calculating anything manually here. When I said sklearn, it is a complete framework, and whoever has created sklearn, the contributor and the creator of sklearn, has kept that in mind. Irrespective of the algorithm, everything remains same. The way you fit the model, the way you predict the model, everything. To answer your question, no, you do not calculate Gini manually, but you have to understand what is Gini, right? For basic reason, for interview, for you to literally be able, let's say, after some time, a new algorithm comes in for decision tree, but that will be based on something or the other. So entropy was the first thing which came in, and then impurity, because people found that entropy used to take a lot of time because of the logarithm, right? So they created the impurity, Gini. Okay, so let's start our sessions today. If you have any specific question like this, the way you have asked that, do we literally need to calculate Gini? So if you have any specific question like this, please ask that and I'll try to answer. Okay. So let's start with the naive Bayes now. Again, I would like to point out all the algorithms, most of them do all sorts of tasks. It's up to you, and this will only come with practice, which algorithm to use. Many a times you try out different algorithm and pick the one which gives you the best result. Okay, so you have learned linear regression. You learned logistic regression. This was for regression. This was for classification. Then you learn decision tree, which could do both, right? We saw that you can solve regression as well as classification problem, both with decision tree. Then was ensemble, which was random forest. Here also you can do a regression as well as classification problem. Okay, now the package is different. So random forest classifier and random forest regressor. There are two functions, but the idea behind it remains the same. In fact, when I was teaching random forest, I had told you what was the purpose of creating random forest, what is the difference between decision tree and random forest, where what are the places where decision tree was lagging? That we needed the random forest. Basically, random forest is an ensemble, right? So random forest is one of the ensemble. There are many. Now let's learn about the naive Bayes. Okay. So before I start naive Bayes, how many of you are aware of the probabilities, conditional probability, and mutually exclusive and independent events Bayes theorem? How many of you are aware of it? Need a quick response. So Pawan knows about it. Okay. Anyone? Because you must have gone through it in your stat class, if I'm not wrong. At least the condition probability. Okay. So let me walk you through it, okay? So for understanding naive Bayes, we have to understand couple of things. First thing is, what is conditional probability? What is mutually exclusive and independent events? Third thing is Bayes' theorem. Hence the name Bayes, naive Bayes, because naive Bayes is completely based on Bayes' theorem, and Bayes' theorem is based on conditional probability. Conditional probability comes from two concepts, which is mutually exclusive and independent. Okay. Bayes' theorem. Once we know this, then we can easily combine these three things and come up with naive Bayes. Now, it has two part, naive and Bayes. So naive is nothing but simplistic. I'll tell you why we say it naive Bayes. What is the purpose of naive Bayes? Why don't we just call it Bayes theorem? Simplistic and Bayes is nothing but from Bayes theorem. Okay. Now, let me start by a concept that I was talking about, which is nothing but conditional probability. Okay. So for that, I will use, let me take you through an example of conditional probability. So conditional probability is based on fundamentals of probability. Okay. The way we write it is like this. P, for just for now, just look at it and I'll explain what is the intuition. Okay. Many likes to write it this, or it is also written as. Okay. So these are not, this is not the formula. This is the way you can write this or this. Both. So both kind of representation is available on different statistical, and statisticians actually like to represent in two ways. Okay. By probability of B. So this is the formula of conditional probability, and let's look what does it mean actually. Okay. Please stop me or ask me question if you didn't understand anything. Okay. So let me take this example. I have taken this example from Wikipedia, and the example says there are two events, event one and event two. Okay. What are these events? Basically, D1 says rolled a the die. Okay. One. So there are two dice basically. This is D1 and this is D2. Okay. Now there are two events. So first thing is, what is the probability that you will get a two on die one when you roll the die one? What is the probability that you will get a two? Simple, right? 1/6. Isn't it? When you just roll the die one, what is the probability that you'll get a two? 1/6. Simple from probability, because there are total six outcomes, right? So how many possible events are there? Sample basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Total number of outcome is six, and you want specifically two. Someone has Hussein. Okay. So I'll just mute you. Okay. Fine. Now the second thing. So this was the only question, that what is the priority that you will get a two when you roll the die one. Okay. Now, if I asked you, so if you'll see, so this is nothing but, you know, the total number of outcomes written when you roll two die. So these are the possible cases, right? D1 and D2. So what will you get? D1, let's say, and D2. So you'll get one on D1, one on D2, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, so on, 2, 1, 2, 2. Last will be 6 1 6 2 6 6, isn't it? These are total space, basically the possible result and outcome, isn't it? Total number is 36. Fine. Now, so if you'll see, this is nothing but whatever you see here is nothing but the addition of the number which appears on die. Okay. So when the die was 1 1, the total addition is 2. 1 2 3, right? 1 and 4 is 5. So this is the summation, nothing else. So I'll just, when I just add these two number, I have filled this table. Okay. So till now, just answered one question, which is what is the probability that D1 will have 2, and we have seen a table which is basically the, it shows the complete distribution when you roll 2 die and what is the summation. Okay. The second question is, can you tell me what is the probability that the summation of D1 and D5 is less than 5? So see, these are all the summations, right? And these are the possible cases basically when you will have summation less than 5, isn't it? This. And after that, everything is greater than 5. Okay, so how many possibility? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So there are total 10 values where when you will throw D1 and D2, and the addition of that will be less than or equal to 5. Okay. And what will be the total sample space? We know that 36, right? So what is the probability? 10 divided by 36, isn't it? So probability of D1 plus D2 less than or equal to 5 is nothing but 10 by 36. First was probability of D1 equal to 2 is equals to 1 by 6. Second is probability of D1 plus D2 less than or equal to 5. Probability is equals to 10 by 36. Okay. And this is the space. Now let me add another condition. What is the probability of D1 equal to 2 given that the sum of D1 plus D2 is less than or equal to 5? So if I move along and I just look at this table which we have been looking. So when these are all the gray areas are where the summation of D1 plus D2 is less than or equal to 5, right? Now, and this is the area when D1 is equals to 2, isn't it? I cannot consider all this because here D1 is not 2. This is the only place where D1 is equals to 2. D1 is equals to 2 satisfies this condition. Also, the summation of D1 plus D2 is less than 5. Satisfies these two conditions. So how many numbers are there? 1 2 3, right? So 3 by 36. Why? Because total sample space is 36, and 10 by 36. If I divide these two things, this is what you will get, right? Exactly, which is nothing but 3 by 10. And this is exactly the conditional probability is. So what is conditional probability? Conditional probability is nothing but probability of an event A given event B. Okay. And the formula for it is this. Probability of event A. This is event one. What is event one? What is an event? Event is nothing but an experiment that you're doing. Okay. That's all. So event one, and this is event two. Probability of event A given that B has already happened. So we write probability of A comma B. Now we have seen it in a, you know, more of a example perspective. So we didn't calculate anything. We just looked at it from a graphical perspective graphically basically. And we could find out this is going to be the result. But are you every time going to draw this table and literally shade all the possible outcomes and then divide it? No, right? So all you got to do is use formula. So now let's have a look at the formula. So the formula says probability of A intersection B by probability of B gives the conditional probability of A given B. Now, what is A intersection B? Also written as A comma B, okay? Just to tell you. Okay, so what was the event A? Event A was D1 is equals to 2 and B was D1 plus D2 less than equal to 5, right? Now, intersection of D1 equal to 2 and D1 plus D2 equal to 5 was nothing but 3, right? Total 3 numbers were there. Isn't it? So 3 divided by, what was the probability of B? Probability of B was nothing but total number of D1 plus D2 less than equal to 5. Total 10 possible outcomes were there in this condition, right? 3 by 10. So this is the formula that we use. Obviously, you're not going to calculate manually, but you need to understand what is conditional probability. And the way you read it is, probability of A conditioned on B, also called conditioned on. So this vertical line, you say conditioned on, okay? How many of you understood? Or is there something which you didn't understand? One note is there that in conditional probability, the denominator P of A intersection B cannot be zero. Okay, this cannot be zero, where probability of B cannot be zero. This is the only condition, right? So I've got one reply, no. So is this like you couldn't understand or did you understand? So, Santosh, when you say you couldn't understand, can you specifically tell me what was it? What was the formula or what I showed on Wikipedia page, the example? Okay, let me quickly reiterate. Okay. Couldn't understand that D1 equal to 2 and D1 plus D2 is less than equal to... Okay. So, Santosh, there are two event. There are two die, right? D1 and D2. These are two die, right? When you throw a die, how many possible outcomes are there? Can you quickly tell me? One, two, three, four, five, six, right? Yes, total six. Now, when I say, what is the probability that you'll get at two? What is the probability you'll get it to? Yes, 1 by 6. Because total, there is only one place, one time that you can get it to. And total 6 number of outcomes are there. 1 by 6. This much you understood. Now, if I ask you, this was question number 1. Now, if I ask you question number 2, what is the probability that the sum of both the, so when you throw both the die simultaneously, then you'll get one number, right? Maybe you get here 1 and maybe you get 2 here. This is how die look like, right? Sorry for the drawing, but I'm just trying to explain. So let's say here is a number 1, here's a number 2. What is the sum of it? 3. Right? So when you throw two dice simultaneously, two dice basically simultaneously, then you get two numbers, right? On each face. What is the probability that when you add these two numbers, The number should be less than equal to 5. So here, what are the total outcomes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you picked this, right? So if I wanted to create that D1 and D2. So let me start 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 1, 6. So here, how many places are there when the summation is less than or equal to 5? Let me add D1 plus D2 here. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, right? So these are the only possible cases, isn't it? Only 4. And this is only when I considered 1. When you throw 2 die, there are total 36 outcomes are there total. So when you keep on doing that, you'll get 10 number total basically. When the summation is less than or equal to 5. And what is conditional probability? Probability of having an event A given that B has already happened. So here my B was nothing but the summation is less than or equal to 10. Sorry, 5. This one, D1 plus D2. Less than or equal to 5 is my event B. And what is my event A? That D1 is equals to 2. So how many possible outcomes are there? So when you see possible outcomes, this is the total feature space. So this is the total feature space. And in this feature space, only these three, three value when D1 is also 2, the first condition, numerator, right? So probability of A. And the summation is also less than or equal to 5, which is probability D1 plus D2 less than or equal to 5. These three, right? So 3 by, so what is the probability of having just D equal to D1 equal to 2? 3. And this one, 10. Probability is 0.3. Now, just a quick. Okay. Just a second, guys. Let me stop sharing my screen for a second.
We've been kind of developing more functionalities for it, as well as kind of refining.
So sorry for that. me share my screen back. Sharing. Okay. I hope everyone can see, right? Now, so this was the first thing. Now, the second concept is independent and exclusive events, mutually exclusive events. Okay, so I'll just give you the formula. Probability of A given B is equals to probability of A. This is an independent event. One example, let's say I told you there are two die, D1 and D2. Okay. When I tell you the event A is nothing but so when I tell you the event A is nothing but getting a 6 in D1, okay? And what is B? Getting a 3 in D2. Now, do you think that one event affects the other event? When you have two independent die, so do you really think if I threw the first die, let's say I got 6 here, so do you really think that if I throw the die 2 and getting a 3 will be affected by this 6? No, right? Because these two are independent event. D1 doesn't bother D1. Sorry, D1 that doesn't bother D2 and D2 doesn't bother D1, right? So these type of events are called independent events. Hence, when you take the formula, so probability of event A given B is equals to probability of A only, because here B is independent. A is independent of B. Okay. Now these are the independent event. Now what is mutually exclusive event? If I told you A is event of getting 3 in D1, B is getting 5 in D1. D1, remember, this is both D1. Now, mutually exclusive event says probability of A given B is equals to probability of B given A is equals to 0. Now tell me, is it possible that given that B the die has 5 on the face, what is the probability of, if I ask you, the die has 3 on the face? It is always 0, right? It cannot happen. Does this make sense? And vice versa. If I get a 5 on my die, if I ask you what is the probability of getting a 3, it is always 3, 0, right? Because at one point, two number cannot appear. Only one number will appear. Either it is 3 or it is 5. And if I say what is the probability of having a 3 here, given that 5 is there, the probability is 0. Right? Does this make sense? Is it clear? Can I get response? Let me ask. So, Xavier, does this make sense to you? What is independent? What is exclusive? Most of the people actually get confused between these two concepts, independent and exclusive. Independent is something when one happens, it doesn't depend on the other. Okay? They're independent of each other. What is mutually exclusive? When one happen, second cannot happen. It is not possible. I think people have just connected and so let me ask Divyanshu. Are you able to understand this? Bhuvna, Riya? Okay, so Pavan says no. Pavan, again, can you tell me what is it that you didn't understand? Just two concepts. This is nothing related to machine learning naive base yet. I am just trying to explain these two concepts because, see guys, naive base is extensively based on probability theory. Okay, you cannot skip probability theory. If you want, I can just show you one example of naive base, which will be just geometric intuition and you will be able to understand. But you won't be able to understand what is conditional probability, where did this conditional probability lead to Bayes theorem. So Pavan, can you tell me what is it that you didn't understand? Independent and exclusive. Let's say I gave you two die, okay? And if I asked you, throw both of them at a time and you got three, okay? On die one, and five on die two. Now you tell me, if I got three in die one, does it actually affect whatever comes on die two? Is it something like if an odd number has come, you cannot get an odd number in die two? Is it something like that? Or if you got an even number in die one, you cannot get an even number in die two? Is it something like that? No, right? So what does it mean? They're both independent, right? They'll happen on their own. And conditional probability says the probability of A given B. So all I'm saying is, what is the probability of A given that B has already happened? Probability of B, A only, right? Why? Because it doesn't matter what happened in B. This is independent. Now, what is exclusive? If I gave you one die and I asked you to throw, let's say you got a three on its face. And if I ask you, what is the probability of four at the same trial? I'm not saying some random, you know, you're just sitting at home and just trying to roll a die. No, in the same, very same trial, when I asked you, you got a three. And if I'm asking you, what is the probability that you have a four? It is zero, right? Because it has already happened. You have already gotten three. You cannot get a four on it. So mutually exclusive cannot happen both at a time. Only one will happen. Hence, the probability of A given B is always zero. So what is the probability of A given that B has happened? I'm saying B has already happened, which means three has already happened. You have already gotten a three on the face of your die. And I'm asking, what is the probability that you get a four? It is zero. Yeah, Surya, you are correct. I hope now it makes sense to you. If it's still not clear, I would suggest connect maybe, you know, offline or go through the video again. I'm sure it will be clearer. Okay. Now let's quickly take one example of conditional probability and then we'll quickly move on to Bayes theorem and naive Bayes. Okay. Because I cannot do without this example. So I always try to go through Wikipedia because No, they have the authentic and you know. We have already seen this example, right? So, okay, so let me cover it in Bayes' theorem. Now, let's quickly move on to Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem is basically, you know, came in existence in 1700. It is that old and is that significant and basic that a complete, you know, a new type of stream is there, Bayesian inference, which we call. Okay. So now this is important because complete naive Bayes algorithm is based on Bayes theorem. What is Bayes theorem? Basically, named after Thomas Bayes. Okay. So one thing I'd like to write right here is this is same, both of them are same. It is just a different notation. Both of them are same, okay? Bayes theorem says probability of A given B is equals to probability of A multiplied by probability of B given A divided by probability of B. This is the formula of Bayes theorem. I can prove this. It is just, you know, very easy, simple proof. I can prove this. But this is the formula you'll have to remember. So how do we get to this formula? Basically, let me keep it here and then I'll try to prove, okay? So that you don't lose the track of it. Let me write. So we know probability of A given B is nothing but probability of A intersection B divided by probability of B, right? Similarly, probability of B by A is nothing but probability of B intersection A divided by probability of A. Now, these two things are same. Statistically, probability of A intersection B is equal to probability of B intersection A. What is intersection? And you can read them as and. Probability of A and B happening. Okay, so probability of A and B is equal to probability of B and A. Same. Okay. So if I take this, I can write probability of B intersection A is equal to probability of B by A multiplied by probability of A. Simply, I just take this right to the left-hand side. And if I use this and substitute it here. Here, what will you get? So I'll rewrite this, okay? Now I'll change the color. I'll rewrite this. This is the conditional probability basically. And I have to get here. So I'll just rewrite this. Probability of A given B is equals to replace probability of A by B from here, which is nothing but this. So probability of A multiplied by probability of B given A divided by probability of B. Simple. I just used the concept of conditional probability. Hence, I had told you that Bayes' theorem is coming out of conditional probability. So unless you understand conditional probability, you won't be able to understand. If I just told you this formula and you have to apply, you won't be able to understand it. Okay. Now, terminology alert. What is this? Let me show this. You simply don't say terminal this probability of A and B. So this is called posterior. This is called prior. I'm using whatever the terminology has been there for 200, 300 years. These are just the English, you know, word for maybe a statistician. Just because we are not aware of these words, so you might find it, you know, difficult to remember it at first. But you don't even have to. All you have to understand is a concept, okay? And this is called, and trust me, you will come across this when you go deeper into, you know, higher algorithms. You'll come across this and you'll definitely be able to relate at that time. It's not about relating, at least you would have heard of these terms, okay? And this is called the likelihood. I'm using just the name. It has got nothing to do with the concept. The concept remains same, okay? And this is called evidence. So in probabilities world, statisticians world, these are the name of the component: posterior, prior, likelihood, and evidence. Okay. So these were the terminologies that I told you. Coming back. So is this clear, guys? So I'll quickly show you one example of Bayes' theorem. Okay. Still we have not. Let me show this example. It'd be really easy, actually. So this is all what we have seen till now. Let me take this example. I'll take more complicated example, slightly complicated, so that you're, you know, able to use it. So even in interview questions, people like to ask, they'll just give you this problem statement and they'll ask you to create Bayes' theorem, or maybe they get the result. Okay. So what is the question? The entire output of a factory is produced on three machines. Okay. So I'll simplify this question for you. What it is saying, you have in a factory, there are three machines, M1, M2, and M3. And all these three machines give you the product. Okay. Now, what it says, the probability, the three machines account for 20%, 30%, and 50% respectively of the total output of the factory. So if the factory produces 100 units daily, 20 of them comes from machine A, 30 comes from machine B, 50 comes from machine C, sorry, C, 3, 1, 2, 3, okay? So what is the probability of machine 1? 0.2, 0.3, 0.5, isn't it? This is the output from each machine. Now, when you prepare something, when you create something, you also get some defected items, right? So the next part of the question says, the fraction of the defective item produced is 5% for first machine, 3% for the second machine, and 1% for the third machine. So what does it say? Probability of the defective item, given that it is coming from machine one, is nothing but 5%, which is 0.05. Similarly, probability of, is it visible or should I use a different color? So probability of defective item, given it is coming from machine B, machine two, is 5% happened, 3%, 0.03. Similarly, probability of D coming from machine three is 1%, 0.01. Now the question, comes, I'll use this space. Okay. So that is visible. Then the question is asking, if an item is chosen at random. Okay. Now you get everything in a, let's say, storage room, all the products is there in the storage room. Now what is saying, you are the inspector which inspects the product. Okay. And you have to find out which machine is basically, you know, creating problem, which is not running perfectly. Maybe defective, you might have to, you know, change some part. So what is saying? An item is chosen at random from the total output and is found to be defective. You found that whatever item you picked is defective. Now the question is asking, what is the probability that it was produced by the third machine? So my question is, I have to find out. And a trick to, you know, write the Bayes equation is, what is the probability that it is produced by third machine? It is saying, I'll quickly write what is the priority it is coming from third machine and what is given that it is defective. It is found to be defective. So this is what I have to find. And I know the equation. What do I know? Probability of M3 given D is equals to probability of M3, probability of D by M3 divided by probability of D. Right? So this you already know. This you already know. It is somewhere priority of defective given it is from machine 3. This one. M3 also know the priority of total number of products coming out of machine 3 is nothing but 0.5. Now you have to calculate priority of defective item. Now one step more. Don't you think the probability of defective items comes from three different machines, isn't it? Machine 1, it can be coming from machine 1, machine 2, machine 3. So you basically expand this. Okay. And trick is you write it something like this. So the probability of defective multiplied by probability of machine 1, sorry, probability of machine 3. Sorry, just a second. I'll tell you one trick to write it, okay? Even if you're not able to learn. So whenever you write this, this is only one part. What is the part? The probability of defective is there. The product is defective. It is coming from machine 3. But in reality, the defective part will be coming from three machines, M1, M2, and M3, right? So always the denominator gets, broken down into probability of M3 defective by M3 plus probability of M2 given probability of defective by M2 plus probability of M3 multiplied by probability of D given M3. So that this denominator gets converted into this. And if you'll see, one of the element is nothing but here M3. Probability of M3 given probability of D by M3. Now you know each and every value. You know M3. What is the value of M3? 0.5 multiplied by probability of defective coming from M3, 0.01 divided by 0.5 into 0.01 plus the defective could be coming from machine 2. So machine 2 is 0.3 multiplied by D by M2 0.03 plus machine 1. Sorry. Machine 3, 2, this is 1. This is by mistake 3, okay? So machine 1 is nothing but 0.2, 0.2 multiplied by D by M1, 0.05. When you solve this equation, you get the answer, this. Okay? I know this is little bit overwhelming in terms of equation, but if you remember it this way, the way I just explained, it will be much clearer. Okay. Fine. Now let's move on. Now come to the Naive Bayes algorithm. Okay. So guys, is this clear to some extent? Okay, Surya says yes, Arjun says yes, Jugendra says yes. Thanks for confirming. So we have understood till now Bayes' theorem, conditional probability, and the independent event and the mutually exclusive event. Now we come to the naive Bayes' theorem. And it is very simple, very, very simple. I don't want to overwhelm you guys with too much of, formula. So how do you want me to go ahead? Like, do you really want me to or just take an example and explain this? It's up to you. Please choose that. I can do both. So I'm getting two different kinds of, just clear the basic concept with one example. You can just say is in detail. Okay. I do understand when you say clear the basic concept with one example, but okay. So let me do balance it with both. Okay. I won't overwhelm you guys with too much of technicality. See, the reason why I choose this Wikipedia also because you should be able to, read all this. Because if you want to really become a data scientist, you should be able to, learn the papers as well, read papers as well, which is being published by a lot of other scientists, researchers. So I'll take just 5-10 minutes to quickly, tell you how this okay, let me use this and explain you. With this example, I use Shatterline's blog, which is really good actually. It has got really good explanation. But we'll quickly spend just 2 minutes to understand this, okay? Trust me, I won't bother you much with too much of see. What is naive Bayes? Basically, let's keep it Bayes only till now. I'll add the naive part to it and then we'll understand why it is called naive Bayes theorem, okay? So if you saw, guys, let's say you have a problem of predicting whether play tennis or not. I'm using the same example because we have seen this example and you guys are really familiar with the data, isn't it? So if I showed you this example, so just look at this data set, okay? What do I have? This is the response or target. This is the feature. Let's say feature one, feature two, feature three. Why am I giving this name? Because every time I can't write outlook, temperature, humidity. Okay. So I'm just calling these as feature one, feature two, feature three, and feature four. Okay. Till now, these are each events. Sorry. So these are each row, right? Each observation. These are nothing but I'll write it as X. This is X one. This is X two. This is how you get the data, right? In data set. X3, so on so forth till X14. Okay. Till now, the target is there, also called response. Now, how many classes are there? So we'll look at naive Bayes classifier. The way we saw logistic regression, it does classification, right? But logistic regression can only do 2-class classification. But naive Bayes basically classification can be done for K classes. It could be anything. It could be predicting your education level. Your undergraduate, your high school, undergraduate, postgraduate, UG, postgraduate, doctor, a PhD. Many class, right? So I'll say this is k classes. It can be used for n number of classes, k number of classes, basically different. But in this problem statement, we only have k is equal to 2 because there are only two classes. Either it is no or yes, isn't it? Now, coming back to our problem. First, let me tell you what is base classifier, and I'll immediately add a knife to it. Okay, while we go through the concept. Fine. What did we see till now? What is a base theorem? So your actually target is to calculate this probability of play is equals to yes given your x feature complete, isn't it? That's what you are trying to solve. For each line, for each row in the data set, I'll try to calculate two things: probability of play yes, play is equals to yes, and play is equals to no given that x, same x, x1, let me say x1 because this is x1. Don't you think whichever's probability is more, you will pick that? Let's say probability of play is equals to yes is more, higher, you'll say that this is the class. And in future, when a new data comes in, all you will do is you'll just give this query and you'll get the probability. Okay. Now, let me erase this. I'm just thinking how to incorporate this also with that, so that you don't feel that I'm just going through the formula, because I know it looks really dreadful. I know that. Okay, got the idea. Fine. What is Bayes' theorem? Let me write Bayes' theorem here. Bayes' theorem say, now I told you that our task is to find the probability of, play is equals to yes. So I'll just write here P is equals to Y. Okay. Given F1, F2, F3, F4. Okay. Till now, I hope everyone is, everyone will be able to relate. Now, what is Bayes' theorem says? It is exactly as Bayes' theorem, like A given B. What does it say? It says probability of A, probability of B by A, probability of B, isn't it? Now, let me write it. Probability of A. What is A here? Probability of yes multiplied by probability of B given A. What is B here? This complete is B, right? And I have told you that we also write B as probability of comma. We use this. So let me rewrite this with that comma basically. Okay, just focus here. Okay, this. What is this? From conditional probability or Bayes' theorem, whatever you may wanna call it, you can call. What is this exactly? Can you see this is as probability of B by A, conditional probability. Probability of B comma A by probability of A. Don't you think this is same? Just multiplied here. So this is nothing but this, right? Probability of B comma A. when I use it here, quality of b comma a, what is b here? This is my b, this is b, this is a, event a. So what is b? F1, F2, F3, F4. F4 given y. Yes, y stands for yes, okay? Okay? Now, this is also shown as probability of F1, F2, F3, F4, and y. Comma. These are our events, right? I can write something like this also. And the denominator would be probability of B only. So this I changed here. Everything is same. And what's the probability of B? Probability of B is nothing but probability of F1, F2, F3, and F4. Right? First tell me, are you able to understand this? Probability of yes, playing tennis is equals to yes, multiplied by the intersection, basically. Okay, joint probability. This is called also called joint probability. Joint probability of all the features and yes. Okay, divided by probability of all the features. Just using Bayes' theorem. Now, for any given data point, here let's say day one, x1 or day one, you have to calculate either this or same thing with no, isn't it? And whichever is higher, you will say that is the chances that you should play tennis or not. So F1, F2, F3, F4 and Y. These are all comma, okay, in between. Divided by F1, F2, F3, F4. Now, if you'll notice one thing, there is one interesting thing. The denominator for both are same, right? Which means my probability of finding, so if I write it, so this is the probability, right? This one is equals to this. And what is this one? The second equation, probability of P is equals to N. So only this will change, right? Only this is changed because that is exactly what I'm trying to find, either yes or no. There are only two classes. And I want to find which class has got the highest probability given the complete data set. When the combination is feature one is sunny, hot, high, weak, what is the probability that it is a no? Same. The feature is sunny, hot, high, weak, what is the probability it is a yes? That's all I'm trying to find. Okay. So I'll have two things, right? If I had three classes, I would have done this for three different classes. And whichever class has the highest probability, I'll say naive-Bayes classifier will classify that particular row as that class, which has got the highest probability. Now, the same thing is probability of B, P is equals to N, given F1, F2, F3, F4, is this. This is the first one. This is the first one. This is the second one. Okay. And in both the case, denominator is same. So with the mathematical rule, I can say that I can eliminate this as of now and I just say not equal to proportionality. Okay? Proportional to. So let me rewrite this and let me save it also so that I can, at the end, we'll now copy it. Okay. So, Harshdeep, can you please okay. Guys, is this clear? Just tell me first. I know it's a little bit tricky, but is this clear what we are trying to do actually? No, that's okay, Harshdeep. Guys, is this clear? Our task is to basically naive based classifiers task is you have to find out probability of playing tennis. Playing tennis is yes, given your all the features. Or probability of playing the tennis is equals to no, given all the features. That's how you will classify, right? At the end, machine learning algorithm will help you to classify a data point, whether yes or no. That's what we are doing. Okay. So we have seen this. So what I'll do, I'll just take the numerator now. So here the equation will become proportionality to probability of play tennis as no, given probability of all the features, comma, sorry, this is a yes, my bad. Okay, so this is yes multiplied by yes. Okay, and this one is proportional to, because I'm removing the denominator, I'm just removing denominator because denominator is same. So whenever I compare, it will not help me to compare. It is just a number which will be there, right? For both the cases, it will be there. This will be proportional to probability of no multiplied by probability of F1, F2, F3, F4, comma N, okay? So these two things just remember, because now I'm going to add the naive part to it. I can show you the derivation if you want, but I don't think I should be, because you guys have like might already be, you know, overwhelmed with too much of probability. But just remember this, and I'll use one example basically, and I'll tell you. Oh, just a second, guys. Guys, am I audible? Okay. I don't know why, but whenever I'm on Zoom, basically our platform, class platform, I don't get notification of battery low. Not sure. So it's okay. So till now we have seen, right? And let me just take this term, because finding yes or no is very simple, right? In complete data set, if I asked you, What is the probability of yes? How many total data points are there? 14. How many yes are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Total 9 by 14 is probability of yes. Similarly, probability of no is equals to 5 by 14. So finding the probability of yes and no is very simple. The difficult task is how to find the probability of F1, F2, F3, F4 and why. Basically the joint probability. This is nothing but joint probability. Okay. This is called joint probability. This is difficult. This is computationally expensive and difficult both. Okay. So what Bayes told or researchers told, let's not make it very complicated. Let's make it simple. And how will you make it simple? Let's use a concept of independence, also called as conditional independence. Okay. And I'll quickly tell you what is conditional independence with an example. It will make more sense to you. Let me take the example. So till here you understood, right? Let me take this example. This one. Let's say you are trying to classify a text. Classification problem, same thing. There's nothing which has been changed, okay? Same thing. But with this actually example, it is very easy to understand the knife part of the Bayes theorem, okay? I'll tell you how. Let's say you have got this data set. This is the text column and it's a tag. So basically you have to tag a particular article as sports or not sports, okay? If this belongs to a sports article or it doesn't belong to a sports article. So the first article is, and I'm saying article, basically text piece. Okay. It can be a full 500 page of article also. It can be one line also. Okay. So the concept remains same. Let's say my first data point is, this is first, second, third, fourth, fifth. First line says a great game. So I have it. I have basically the target as sports given, right? In supervised machine learning, you always have the target. Then you predict it for the upcoming data. Now, second is the election was over, not sports, right? It's more of political. So I'll just say not sports. Now, very clean match, sports, right? A clean but forgettable game, sports. Just a second, guys. Sorry. Okay. Now the third is very clean match. It is sports, right? A clean but forgettable match. Still sports. It was a close election, not sports. Okay. So this is my data set. Now, what was the challenge that we were facing? When I said challenge, basically what is computationally heavy and all of that I told you, right? So what was that? So basically you have to find out probability of a given data, a great game, the target probability of playing tennis equals to yes or no, right? So same, a tag is a sports tag, probability of sports given the data as a great game, or probability of not sports given a great game. Whoever will have the higher probability, you'll choose that. So obviously, when you completely train the model, you'll get the probability of being this particular article as a sports is really high than this not being a sports. Okay. Isn't it? Now the Bayes theorem, I'll exactly use the Bayes theorem. So Bayes theorem says, and we'll make it naive. Okay, so Bayes' theorem says two things: probability of being sports given, probability of sports given grade game. I'm not going to write every time this is grade game. I'll just write quickly in a short this, right? Okay. This, I'll write one above the other, not just forget this, okay? Is equals to probability of sports multiplied by probability of Bayes theorem, right? Bayes theorem. Grade game given sports, Bayes theorem, divided by probability of grade game. Isn't it? This is the Bayes theorem. And you have to find out not sports, same grade game, same thing, everything same, not sports, same thing, grade game. So till now we have seen in the tennis problem also that as the denominator of both the cases are same, so we ignore this and we know that it becomes directly proportional to only numerator. Okay, and this is pretty easy to find out: total number of instances which is sports, total number of instances which is not sports. Okay, this is simple calculation. The calculation expensive or difficult part is this. Now, how do you use the naive concept and make it simpler? I'll tell you that. Okay. So, do you think if an article is having every time this was a great game and you'll have 100 article, do you really think it will always occur in this sequence only? A great game. Do you really think every time you'll get this same sequence? It is really difficult to get this same sequence. Always remember, intuition is someone might write game is great. So do you really think in English, just because the words are here and there, you will say that this is not a sports column? This is not a sports article. Just because you didn't find everything in same sequence? Quickly, can you give me answer? Does this logically make sense to reject it as a sports article just because you didn't have the same sequence? If you're relating till here, please. How can I see the texts? Okay. So I'm not sure if I missed the answers. So Yogendra says no. Harshdeep also says no. Yes, it doesn't make sense, right? Yes. So what people said, it is really difficult to find this specific sequence. And even if you find, you really look for it. This sequence after this sequence after this sequence. And you have to have million and thousands and of record. So what people say is, let's forget about the sequence. Let's just break it into probability of A multiplied by probability of grade in a data set. Okay. In first row, single row, row one. Okay. X one in our tennis problem, it is X one. Okay. And probability of game. This is nothing but conditional independence. Intuition. Where you are not looking for the sequence. Now this will make more sense because you are individually multiplying the probability of A, probability of grade, probability of game. Here also probability of game, probability of is, and probability of grade. Now maybe this will be a very small change is these two number, this number and this number, just because here it is A, here it is, but still this won't be very far away, right? Maybe the probability here is 0.87, maybe here you'll get 0.84, but still you'll get the higher probability for sports. And that is the naive part of it. So naive part says make the data conditionally independent, so that you don't look for the sequence and all the inputs are independent. Okay. Now, going back to the example, now this will become really, really simple for you guys now. Now, so we have seen this data set. Okay. What you do is you calculate something like this, a table, and this is nothing but what we had calculated, given A, given B, this only. Harshdeep, can you? Yeah, works fine. I'm not sure even if everyone is able to see. I just, you know, whenever I see, I just point it out. So just look at it right now. Just I'll tell you, and these are the exact basically what. Guys, are you able to see the pop-ups that I get? Can anyone confirm quickly? Anyone? Okay, so just give me a second. Okay. So let's see this. And this is really like what we have been seeing till now. So what I'm saying, probability of Outlook given the class, yes or no. Okay. Outlook is having three kinds of classes, level, right? Sunny, overcast, rain. Now play will have yes and no. So what I'm doing in the complete data set, how many sunny in the data set when the Outlook is sunny and the play is yes. Same, the Outlook is sunny and the play is no. How many times? So it says, let me check also. We'll go and check also. So it says total 9 yes are there. We have seen this, right? Total 9 yeses and 5 no. Total 14 data points. Okay. Says sunny twice, overcast 4, rain 3. Okay. Let me have a look here. So it says when it is yes. So let me first check the yeses. Yes, 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 yes. And in out of these yeses, how many times I have Outlook as sunny? No, yes, 1, 2. This is not so here. No. 2 times, right? That's what I have calculated. 2 times. Similarly, play no will be 3 times. So when you do this for all the columns, so Outlook with classes yes or no, because if you remember, what was the formula? Probability of play yes given the probability, sorry, given feature 1, feature 2, feature 3, feature 4. And when I broke it, used the conditional independence, it became, and the Bayes theorem also, don't forget Bayes theorem it became probability of yes multiplied by probability of conditional independence basically. So when you use conditional independence, it becomes something like this: probability of yes given F1 multiplied by probability of yes given F2, probability of yes given F3. Even if I have 1,000 features, it'll go on like this. But just because I have 4 features, probability of yes given F4, okay? Divided by, what is the denominator? Probability of F1, F2, F3, F4, okay? We know, we had ignored this, right? We don't need this because every time this will be same. This will not change. So we just focus on numerator, okay? So when you do this for all the features, so if you will see, notice here. Now comes the fun part. Let's say you calculated this. So, after calculating everything given, so let's say you have a new data point, which we call it query, okay? Let's say new query is there. Query says the outlook is sunny, temperature is cool, humidity is high, wind is strong, and you have to find out whether you should play tennis or not. Play or don't play, okay? How do we do this? Let me use Bayes' theorem. This is the Bayes' theorem we know, right? Class play equal to yes, given the new data point x. What is data point? Play sunny, given class is equals to yes. Into play cool, class is equals to yes. I told you, right? Play probability of yes, given probability of yes, given feature one. Now, what is feature one? Feature one is nothing but outlook. This is outlook. This is cool temperature. This is high humidity. Strong wind, I think. Yes, this was wind. And this is nothing but the probability of class. So numerator probability of class, this is same thing here. This one multiplied by probability of y, yes. Every time you will say yes, okay? Here yes, yes, yes. Sunny given yes, cool given yes, high given yes, strong given yes. So when you refer this table, let me take just this one. Probability of sunny given class as yes. Sunny. Where was sunny? Sunny. Class as yes. 2 by 9. See? Similarly, you will get this. 3 by 9, 3 by 9, 3 by 9, 9 by 4. When you multiply it, so you get probability as 0.005. And you will do the same thing for probability play as no. Okay? You will get 0.02. And which one is greater? So in this question, we got probability of play is equals to play. Play is equals to yes as less than probability of play equals to no, right? So we'll choose this one. So we say whatever the future data. So this was future data, right? The query, the new query I had told you. You need the historical data to calculate this table basically, and Python will do this for you. Okay, this is called likelihood table because we are doing nothing but likelihood only, right? Posterior, prior, likelihood, remember? So this is what the naive Bayes algorithm is all about. And if I showed you, the code as simple as it gets for linear, logistic, whatever. Import the dataset dot load wine. So wine dataset is the so basically features are alcohol, malic acid, ash, alkalinity of the ash, magnesium, total phenols. So what are the content of each feature, and the class 0, class 1, class 2. Okay, label of the wine, basically maybe strong wine, old, or maybe old wine, new wine, whatever. The class could be anything. And this is the best part of being a data scientist. You don't, even if you don't even know the what the class means, you still will be able to classify, isn't it? Would like to know. I'll see at the end. So this is how the data looks like. So I read the data and then I split it, train test split, right? Because I do want to train my model on the training data set and then test it also, right? If my classification is doing good or not. Okay, so X train, X test, Y train, Y test, train test split. You pass the X and the target, feature and the target. The size you pass, 0.3 basically, test will be 30%. And what is random set? If you don't know, let me tell you, random set is something like whenever you sample the data as train and test, every time when you sample it, you'll sample the same things. Okay, that's exactly the random set. So that if five different person are running the same algorithm, if I told you keep the random set at 109, then everyone should be getting the same result actually when you compare. So from sklearn.knifebase, import Gaussian knifebase. You create, so I had told you this is object creation. This is fitting. In fitting, you pass two things, X and Y. Then you predict gnb.predict. You just pass the X test. This is Y test, right? This is by prediction. You will have the actual value also. This is the actual value. This is the predicted value. Then you calculate the accuracy score. It is a classification problem. I had told you accuracy is the measure you take. So 90.7, basically 90.7% is the accuracy. Okay. Any question in knifebase? Now, if someone asks you why is it called a naive Bayes algorithm, or asks you in a naive Bayes algorithm, how you know, solve the problem of complexity, computational complexity, you should be able to say that we use conditional independence for all the features. Hence the name naive. Okay. And we use Bayes theorem and conditional independency concept to come up with the probability for the classes. Okay. Any question? Any question till now? Quickly. Is this clear? Makes sense? Okay. Santosh says, so Arjun is saying, when we calculate any accuracy, why it differs from one result to other sometime? It is basically happening because you are whenever you sample your data, right? So you might be taking some points in the sample in the first train in the first time and not in the second time. That's the only reason. And many times, so that is one of the reason. And many times, see, optimization and all, I had told you, right? Doesn't matter which algorithm you choose. So at the back end, it always does the optimization to get at the minimum value. The error function could be different. So there are different algorithms for optimization. So what happens is, in a hill like this, okay, your target is to reach this minimum value, but at times you just reach this value. You're not able to go here, but it is random. Okay. It is random. That's why. So a very small difference will be there. Not necessary always, but yeah, sometimes. And also the fact that you always sample it differently. Okay. No question in knifebase, right? So again, is asking, I guess the mathematics behind it, this is little complicated. So when we go through this again, definitely the things will be more clear. Yes, again, definitely. I'm sure if you read any article and all, you'll definitely get confused if you don't have the background. if you have the background, how you have arrived at it, then it will be more clearer. Okay. And I hope with the concept that I have provided, it will definitely be helpful only. Even if you go and read any blog or paper, you'll be able to relate to it actually. Okay, let's move on to the next algorithm, which is k nearest neighbor. Okay, and this algorithm, actually there is nothing mathematically there is nothing in this algorithm, but intuition wise yes, and people very rarely use this algorithm also, but it is always good to know about this algorithm, maybe from a technical perspective, interview perspective. Okay, so KNN. So KNN stands for K nearest neighbor. So let me first, you know, let me say you have this data set. Okay. If I ask you, there is a new point. Which is this? What will be your guess? Which class does it belong to? Is it blue class? Is it red class? Quickly, can I get a response? Red class. And why did you say so? Red class? Just a simple. What did you just think? Arjun says it's nearer to that class. Yes. And that's all about point you draw in red one. Okay. Yeah, I did draw it in red one, but the idea of you picking the picking it as, because this point will be random, right? Maybe this will be here. Maybe this will be here. Anywhere, but you came. So if the point was here, you would say it will belong to blue class, right? That is the idea basically. K nearest neighbor stands for, KNN stands for K nearest neighbor. So basically what happens is, let's say just as of now, K is 3. Okay. I'll tell you how do you come up the optimal K. So idea is when you take 3 nearest neighbors. So this is the first neighbor. This is, let's say, the second neighbor. This is, let's say, the third neighbor. And you take the majority of the vote. That's it. If this one is from first class, because this is a future data point, you don't know the class of this, right? And these are the historical data points. You know the class of this. And if out of 3 neighbor, 2 of them says that you belong to class red, and 1 says you belong to class blue, you'll pick class as red. That's it. There is no mathematics. There is no probability. It is purely geometric algorithm based on neighbors. Now, the only math part here is the distance. How do you, it's like vote one out. No, not vote one out. It's like the majority voting. So Arjun, you said it's like vote one out. Maybe you are saying the same thing which I'm explaining or saying, but yeah, vote one out is like, yeah, I think you meant the same thing. Okay. The only mathematic part is when you calculate the neighbor, right? Let's say this is the new point. Let me go here. let's say whenever you are trying to find a point, so let's say this is the new point. You don't know this triangle. You have not seen this triangle yet. Which class does it belong to? You don't know. Let's say in the feature space, these are the neighbors. And this is also one neighbor. So in real scenario, this is the data type you will get, right? What you do, you basically take that and you calculate a distance of three nearest neighbor. Okay, this one. Maybe the second nearest neighbor is this one. Maybe the third nearest neighbor is this one. Maybe. What is this? This is nothing but distance, right? So in a 2D space, if there are two points, x1, x2, let's say this is A, let's say this is B, let's say this is C, let's say this is D. What is the distance between A and B? What is this distance? Simple Pythagoras, right? Also people call Euclidean distance. But simply, if you don't know the Pythagoras, remember from Pythagoras, even if you don't know the Euclidean distance, just remember it from the Pythagoras theorem. Why? I'll tell you. So what is this? This is a right angle, right? Pythagoras theorem, I'm not sure, I'm presuming everyone is aware of Pythagoras theorem. So what Pythagoras theorem says, let's say this is what you're trying to find, the Z distance basically. What is Z? Z is nothing but Pythagoras theorem says Z square is equals to this square plus this square. So what is this? This is nothing but B minus A. B minus A square plus what is this? This is total D and this is C. When you subtract D from C, you'll get this, right? D minus C whole square. This is Pythagoras theorem, which says hypotenuse square is equals to base square, perpendicular square plus base square. And when you take this square root this side, so it becomes Z is equals to root over B minus A whole square plus D minus C whole square. This is also called Euclidean distance. Okay, in geometric coordinate geometry also people read Euclidean. Note it because interview people asks. If I'm not wrong, this is the spelling. Euclidean distance between two point X and Y is nothing but Y2 minus Y1 whole square plus X2 minus X1 whole square root over. Now, this is for 2D. Even if you had 17 features, you'll do something like this. X, Y, Z, P, Q, R, S. So if you had three dimensional, let's say you had Z, Y, and X, what will you do? Z2 minus Z1 whole square plus Y2 minus Y1 whole square plus X2 minus X1 whole square. So the concept remains same. You can have it for n dimension. Okay. So you pick K nearest neighbor and you see, you calculate the distance basically. And how do you pick the nearest neighbor? By calculating distance. I just told you, right? So let's say I have to find three nearest neighbor. I'll calculate the distance of that point from every point and I'll take the least three points. Okay. Top, bottom three points. I'll say that these three are the neighbors. I get the distance. Those three are neighbors. I'll just take the class of that three neighbors and I'll say whoever is the majority is the class. Okay. Now, how do you decide on the K value? Interview question. How do you decide on K in K NN. Which one is completely random, Arjun? What is it saying? The K value? Okay. Let me tell you this with an example. And this is also the drawback of nearest neighbor, okay? Let's say you have a data set like this. Completely scattered. And this is all the shortcomings of k nearest neighbor, okay? So thing is, let's say I am coming with a new point, which is this. And I calculate the k nearest neighbor. Always remember, you always pick, try to pick the k as odd number, okay? So that you don't have a equal voting, okay? So let's say this is my first neighbor. This is my second neighbor. This is my third neighbor. This is my fourth neighbor. This is my fifth neighbor. Okay. So here three of them are saying it should be blue class. Two of them are saying it is red class. Don't you think even if you're able to classify it, okay, it is just by margin of one number. Don't you think? You should be having like more confidence, right? Only one people is saying it is from blue class and at least four people is saying it is from red class. Vice versa, whatever. So the shortcomings is, or limitations is not good for scattered data where you don't have a correct definition of classes. Now, if I ask you, let's say you pick k equal to 10, what will happen? Don't you think you're unnecessarily making all the data point as your neighbor? Don't you think? When I do k, so this will be my neighbor, 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 this will be my neighbor. Unnecessarily, I'm making all the data points as my neighbor. Which means k should not be too high and k should not be too low also. Why? If I have just two value of k, what means you are just believing on two low people. Like in a voting, it is just like you are trying to believe on two data points and you are trying to make your decision on only two data points, what they say. So how do you decide on k value? You basically do something called as cross-validation. I'll tell you what is cross-validation. Let's say the answer is cross-validation. Answer is cross-validation. I have talked about this when I was talking about the machine learning life cycle or flow. How many of you knows about cross-validation? Could you tell me? I'll explain with 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. I'll just take 5. So this is a data set. Let's say you have just 5 row. Okay. Just for simplicity, just to understand what is cross validation. And this is train and this is test. Okay. Train, test. Train and then you have one data point as test. Here this is just 5 data set. In reality there will be 1000 data point. Maybe you will choose 200 data points as your test. Okay, then next step here, same 5 data points, but data remains same, right? Here also 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here what you'll do, you'll take this as train and this as train. In here, what you'll do? This as train and this as train. This is test. This is test. So what you do, you take a chunk of your data set and you'll do this for 5 times. 4, 5. Changing the test basically. Okay. First here a test will be this chunk. Then you change it. This chunk. Then you change it. This chunk. In first value, k will be 1. In second, k will be 2. Third, k will be 3. Fourth, k will be 4. K will be 5. You'll run your k nearest model 5 times with cross validation. This is nothing but cross validation. So what it means, cross validation means you take one, you basically take a subset of your data and for validating actually, this is validation data set. Okay. And this will look something like this. For k in range, you always start from 1k value till 7. You don't go beyond 7, definitely. Hit and trial. Yes, Yogendra. What you do, you model dot fit x train, y train. Okay. Model dot predict x validation, y validation. Sorry, predict means not y. Okay. Don't. You'll get the y predict is equals to model dot fit x validation. Validation, right? You are doing validation. Now you calculate accuracy. How is accuracy calculated? Accuracy score. Y actual, you'll be having Y validation, right? Y validation and YP, predicted value. You store it somewhere. Let's say I store it accuracy in the list. I do this for all from 1 till 7. Every time I calculate the accuracy and wherever the accuracy is maximum, I pick that particular K. What it means? It means when you increase, so definitely you'll classify, right? And whenever you classify, if the K value is 4 and you did the best classification, that means that K is the best K. Okay. Guys, is this clear? Can I get a couple of more responses? Can I get a couple of more responses, guys? Which one, Santosh? I'll take 10 minutes more. That's it. Which one? This one? Okay. So did you understand this K concept? What is K nearest neighbor? Did you understand this? First tell me. Yeah, I got it. So is it just that how do you choose on K value? Okay. So basically K is nothing but hit and trial method. And how do you do that? You train your model multiple times. Okay. And you use cross validation for it. What is cross validation? Cross validation is nothing but in the complete training data set, you take 80% of data as training and then 20% as validation data set. This is not the test data set. Okay. Once you train the model and you finalize on the K, then you predict on the test data set. So cross validation is a cross validation data set. Okay. This is called validation data set. So now you take these many train chunk, this chunk as train, this chunk as test, and K as 1. So in here, what it will happen, every point will just look at one neighbor basically. This is nothing but k equal to neighbor, right? K nearest neighbor, one neighbor, only one neighbor. And whatever that neighbor is saying, you'll say, yeah, you are the same. Just to give you an example, I'm not sure. Let's say you are sitting in a flight, okay? Let's say you are sitting in a flight. One, two, three, four. Usually there are three seats, but let's say there are five seats, okay? Now you are Indian. And the person sitting right beside you is somehow Chinese person. And the person sitting right beside you is, let's say, American person. Here is Indian. Here is Indian. If I asked you, can you tell me what is the, where this plane is in? Or where is this plane going to or coming from? Classify this. What are the type of people sitting in this plane? Your basic approach will be, okay, let me just look towards my left and towards my right. Okay. When you look at towards your left, you will see a Chinese person. So you'll think, okay, Chinese people are there. That means this is in China, maybe. Because you are Indian, you know, you just want to look at your left and right. But you looked at your right, you said, oh, there is an American person also. Now, how do you decide whether person is, you're in China or in America? Or whether the population, most of the population is Chinese or Americans. How do you know that? No, right? So at least you'll have to see at, you know, maybe 2% towards your left, 2% towards your right, or maybe 1% towards your behind and behind you and 1% in front of you, sitting in front of you. At least then you'll have an idea, right? Oh, so majority are Indian. That means this is, you know, a majority of the population is Indian population, not Chinese or Americans, right? That is exactly the K nearest neighbor. You cannot look at too small k. You cannot look at too many k. You have to find out how many people you have to look at. For that, what you do is cross-validate. So for cross-validation, this is like hit and trial. You start from one neighbor. Let's suppose you train your model with one neighbor. Okay, here. I'm sure you have gone through the Python. I was the one who took Python, right? So what do? You fit the model with k equal to 1. Here model is k nearest model, right? KNN model. Okay. You fit the model. You predict the model. Here you have taken a parameter k equals to 1. Then you get the accuracy. I know k equal to 1 is a bad choice. I know that. But still, I'll start from k equal to 1. I'll go till k equal to 7. Because beyond 7 doesn't make sense. It's like looking at everyone. Okay. So, and the optimal is always K3 or 4 or 5 is the always optimal one. Okay. You start from K equal to 1, you go till 7, each time you check the accuracy. And wherever you got the best accuracy means you are correctly classifying the classes, data points. You are correctly classifying the data points. Wherever you get the best accuracy, you pick that K. And then you train your, so here you are doing the cross validation, right? Then you train complete model on the optimal K. Maybe k equal to 4 is the optimal k. Complete train it and then you predict it on a test data set. Okay. Let's quickly have a look at the code. So here I have used Boston house price data set. Okay. Every time I didn't want to use a classification problem, so I have used regression problem. But the idea behind it remains the same. Okay. So, in regression, what you do? You take the mean. I had told you in a decision tree. Whenever it is regression, please note this. People ask, is this in interview? How do you use decision tree for regression problem? Because you will always tell easy to, you know, calculate and make a tree for classification problem. Basically, when you have categorical data, how do you do it when you have numerical data points? You basically take the mean or median. Okay. Here you are taking voting. Here you will take mean and median. That's it. Reading the data set, splitting the data set. You know how to split a data set, right? Train, test, split. Basically, I got a feature as all the x's, target name as my y equal target. Here you have to predict the, you have seen this data set earlier. That's why I'm not going through the data set. If you want, I can go. So this is the per capita crime rate by town. So the problem statement is predict the price of a house in Boston City. And the feature is per capita crime. If a crime is high, will you go and buy a house in that region? No, right? So basically, price of a house depends on what feature? The size of the house, the number of the bedroom in the house, what is the locality of the house, what is the air condition of the house, all of this. So all of these are same. Here is the crime rate. Here is the proportion of residential land zone for lots over 25. So in complete area, how many people? Is it too densely populated? Charles River. So basically, there is a river going, close to the locality. It is good, right? So nitric oxide concentration, average number of rooms per dwelling, weighted distance to 5 Boston employment centers. So if this is the house, so how many employment centers are there? Basically, you like to live in a place where there are more employability or the employable rate is high, right? So median value of owner occupied homes. So this is the price of the house in thousands of dollars, basically MEDV. Okay. So you read the data. Everyone knows what is this, right? Here I am storing the name of all the features from my data set, complete data set. I just leave the MEDV. This is all I'm storing in feature names. Now I'm creating a data frame from just feature. Same way, target name I'm taking whatever is not available in the feature name, which is nothing but MEDV. So here I'll create data frame from target. So I have two data frame. Feet will have all the X. Target will have just a data frame with Y, which is MEDV. Y, okay. Now I'll split the data set 80-20. 80%, 20%. This is my train data set. This is my train data set. This is my test data set. Okay. Just resetting the index. Even if you don't do it, doesn't matter. Just looks good. Then what I'm doing? I'm basically creating a function calc RMSE R2 square. Even if you don't create a function. So what was the person behind this function is, let's say you are making 5 different models for classification. Every time you don't want to use this line R2 score. Instead, what will you do? Whatever the predicted value from any model, true value will always remain same. This will completely change, right? Every time. So model 1 will give me biped of something else. Model 2 will give bipedition of something else. So this is nothing but, more sophisticated way of, why have I included this in my code? I could have just used only this line. Reason is, as you are moving along in the course, you should be able to understand how to write more sophisticated code, more reusable code. Okay. Reusable is the key. So this is how you write reusable code. Now model building KNN from sklearn import neighbors RMSA value. This is the accuracy. I had told you I'll create an accuracy, right? I'll keep on storing the accuracy for 7 iterations. Here RMSLE, because the regression problem has root mean squared error loss function. Remember, algorithm can change. There you are using linear regression. Here you're using k nearest neighbor. But the loss function for regression problem is RMSE. Basically, y predicted minus y actual whole square. This is error, squared error. What I'm doing? I am making the model with k is equals to k plus 1. Why k plus 1? Because it starts from 0. K equal to 0 doesn't make sense. So I'll start from k equal to 1. I could have done something like this also. Range, I have taught Python to you guys, right? So you know, range 1 equal to 20, 1 to 20. So k will automatically start from 1. So I will not have to use this k equal to 1, okay? Neighbor dot k nearest regressor, k neighbor regressor, k neighbor classifier, okay? K neighbors regressor, neighbor equal to k. Here in the first iteration, k equal to 1. Model.fit, model.predict. Error is square root mean squared error y pred. RMSLE value, whatever I calculated, I just append it here. I'll do it for k equal to 1 to 20. I'm doing it for k equal to 1 to 20. Okay. And then I'm plotting. What am I plotting? Here is the error value of the list, RMSLE list. Here is the k equal to 1, k equal to 2, k equal to 3. I want to know, as I increase my k from 1 to 20, how my error is performing. Whether it is decreasing, whether it is increasing. Okay. Because that's how I check the k value, right? So here I'm using grid search, cross validation. I told you, right? So in all this RMSE, from k equal to 1 till 20, I have got least k at k equal to 3. When k was 3, I got the least error. See, here the error kept on decreasing from k equal to 1 to k equal to 2. As I started increasing the k value to 4, 5, 6, 7, the error started increasing. The reason was simple. Because if I have k equal to 10, 7 of my neighbor is saying that it is positive class. Sorry, not 7. 4 of my neighbor are saying positive class, 6 of my neighbor is saying negative class. Obviously, I'll start misclassifying, right? Because I'm not sure. Now, I'll create the model with k equal to 3 because this was just finding the model. The same thing I'll do here, but this time I know for sure that k is 5, 3, okay? So, k nearest neighbor, neighbor equal to 3, fitting the model. This is just calculating the time. How long is it taking to fit the model, okay? KNN fit, predicting, KNN predict, accuracy. So it took, with k equal to 3, it took 0.11 second for fitting and R2 was 74%. R square, right? Remember R square is the metric for regression problem. What is regression? When you have numerical number, continuous variable, target is continuous. Accuracy is the metric for classification. When you have categorical variables. Fine. So this brings us to the end of both naive Bayes and k-nearest neighbor. I hope you were able to understand whatever I'm teaching. If not, please send me questions on Slack. So Yogendra is saying, can we get those handwritten notes? Okay, I'll do it quickly. I'm so sorry. I think you have been asking. I'll do it. Just give me a couple of hours. I'll do it from starting, from basically our linear regression till now. Okay, I'll give everything. You'll get it as an image. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Have a good night. Let's end this session. And what is the next topic for next class? I'm not sure, Yogendra. So BI team will create a schedule and they'll let you know. Okay. Thank you. I hope the mathematics, I know it is a little tricky and overwhelming, but if you keep on, you know, reading and go through it again, definitely you'll be having the maths also. So always machine learning, learn machine learning with mathematics. So mathematics behind it is very useful. And that's what makes you different from the other. Okay. Who just go through the 2 minutes video of linear regression, the geometric interpretation or intuition. Okay. Have a good night. See you in the next class. Thank you.